Remember when the pandemic started and some people were really into baking bread? Whether you sampled your friend's sick sourdough recipe or just rolled your eyes at this fad, you can actually thank an ancient virus for your ability to eat bread. When you chew on a piece of bread for a while, it starts to taste sweet. That's because an enzyme in your saliva is breaking it down into sugar. Our ancestors couldn't do this, which made bread and other carbs difficult for the body to process. But all that changed in response to a viral infection. After our ancestors recovered, they developed a new enzyme in their saliva that breaks down carbohydrates. Now, while it's kind of cool that an ancient virus gave us the ability to enjoy quarantine bread, our long history with viruses has often been destructive, as the COVID-19 pandemic shows. We've been fighting against viruses for a long time, basically since life began on this planet. But this pandemic marks a turning point in how we fight back. Viruses are in everything. They can infect animals, plants, bacteria, and even other viruses. And this is due to the one thing that a virus does best, communicate.
It's a communicable disease. It communicates into our genome. It's the most dynamic part of the genome of all living organisms.
This is Luis Villarreal. He's a professor emeritus at UC Irvine and founded the Center for Virus Research. Now, communication is a two-way street. Let's look at COVID-19. When the virus is outside of the body on its own, nothing is happening. It has nothing to communicate with. But once it enters the cells in our nose and lungs, everything changes. You can think of a virus like an instruction manual. It uses a living cell as the machinery to put its instructions into motion.
You know, one cell can make a million copies of a virus. So that means whenever they replicate, they generate a whole population of offspring.
In this case, COVID-19 is using our respiratory cells as a copy machine to make more and more copies of these instruction manuals so they can infect other cells in our body. This keeps going until the virus runs out of cells to infect or the body figures out how to stop it. That's where vaccines come in. These allow humans to speed up immunity against viruses. The first one ever created was for smallpox. A doctor realized that people who got a more mild virus called cowpox seemed to be immune to smallpox. By fighting off cowpox, the body learned to recognize smallpox and produce antibodies to ward it off. This is fundamentally how vaccines function today. But with modern vaccines, we don't have to get sick with a virus to gain immunity. Scientists either create a weakened virus that can't replicate or harvest small, harmless parts of the virus.
You concentrate it so that it makes an effective dose. You have to inactivate it with some chemical or biological agent, and you inject it into people as an inactivated virus. This is a very historic way of making vaccines.
That's how the flu and hepatitis B vaccines work. They allow the body to easily fight off weakened or harmless bits of the virus, which then trains the body to fight against the real infection. If you feel a little sick after you get a vaccine, it's because it's working. Your body is learning how to respond to a virus. However, the problem with developing vaccines this way is that it takes a long time. The fastest one, the mumps vaccine, took at least 4 years to make. That's because scientists have to first identify a harmless section of the virus and then reproduce enough of it in a lab to make a vaccine. Having enough for clinical trials can take months, and producing enough for the entire planet can take much longer. We just don't have that kind of time during a deadly pandemic. Luckily, scientists have figured out how to speed up the process. For decades, they've been working on a new type of vaccine called mRNA or messenger RNA. Like viruses, the mRNA carries a set of instructions, but they don't have any viral material in them. mRNA vaccines have one purpose, and that's to tell the body to make harmless spike proteins found on the COVID-19 virus. Rather than spending years in the lab making these proteins for a vaccine, our body can easily do it in a matter of weeks. Now, this all might sound a little scary, like some mad scientist is altering your DNA or putting microchips in your body. But mRNA is already found in your cells. The cell nucleus encodes instructions into mRNA to create proteins that control bodily processes, like hormones, for example. Since the mRNA in the vaccine is not produced by your nucleus, where our DNA is kept, it never goes in there. It just joins the stream of other mRNA working to produce proteins and regulate our bodies. And once your body has read the vaccine's instructions and starts making proteins, it just throws the mRNA away. Now that's vastly preferable to letting COVID-19 or other viruses we vaccinate for work their way through your cells. If it doesn't kill you, it could create a problem we don't fully understand. And we can't guarantee the changes viruses leave behind are good, like being able to digest bread. So now that the mRNA vaccine is getting our cells to produce the COVID-19 spike protein, we can quickly move to the next step, clinical and human trials. This is why the first COVID-19 vaccines were the fastest ever developed. It all happened in less than a year. But what about the next pandemic? Scientists warn that these kind of outbreaks are on the rise. Louise thinks we should start preparing now. We already have a good idea of what viruses are out there that could cause the next pandemic.
We could push it even a step further by making all these things into phase 1 trial experimental vaccines well before they're needed.
This would give us a huge head start with developing vaccines for viruses before they cause a widespread pandemic. We could have a team of scientists assessing what viruses are out there and preparing vaccines ahead of time. Now, prevention, control, and treatment during pandemics will always be important, but it would be nice to know that the next time there's a threat, we have the tools in place to save lives and reduce the catastrophic effects of a global pandemic.
Hey there, my name is Aiden Arisaw-Singham, and I'm president of the UC Student Association. I got vaccinated last month because I know that getting a vaccine helps protect your community and your family. If you're in California, you can go to myturn.ca.gov, and if you're elsewhere in the US, you can go to vaccine.gov. And I encourage you to get vaccinated if you haven't already.